what you're going to hand me even before you open your mouths. You're going to tell me you don't believe my story and give me that don't make me laugh expression on your smug faces.
Look, I'll tell you what. You stay put out there, I'll come to you.
Let's get married right away.
How far are you going?
L.A. Not many people stop for a guy these days. Afraid of a stick-up, maybe.
This buggy belongs to a guy named Haskell. That's not you, mister.
Now, wait a
minute.
Shut
up. You're a cheap crook and you killed him.
So what else was there to do but hide the body and get away in the car?
Your eyes, ooh, your kisses too.
Even if you did tell the cops I was in on it with you, what could they do to me?
I can't believe that you're in love with me.
Are you Charles Haskell, Jr.?
Yes.
There was no time to lose. Every minute I had to be Charles Haskell was dangerous.
Hey, you, this your car?
By that time, I'd done just what the police would say I did, even if I didn't.
Maybe it's a good thing you met me. You'd have got yourself caught, sure.
Whichever way you turn, fate sticks out a foot to trip you.
With me.
Hello, all. Welcome to Saturday Matinee, presented by the Denver Public Library. Today, we are going to be discussing Detour, 1945's film noir classic, directed by Edgar G. Ulmer, starring Tom Neal, Ann Savage, and Claudia Drake. A couple of housekeeping things first. This discussion is being recorded for future viewing on YouTube, but for your privacy, only the hosts and panelists' videos are captured. So please keep your mics muted during the discussion so we can avoid any potential interruptions. Around that time that we put up the video, a full list of all the other films and titles, books, poems, movies that we talked about will be made available to everybody. We'll email those to all our participants. So don't worry about taking notes. Please use the chat today to communicate with each other and to ask our panelists questions. We'll have a short question and answer session at the end of the discussion. So please get your questions into the chat as soon as possible. And we'll address as many of those as we can in the last 10 to 15 minutes or so. My name is Andrew with the Denver Public Library. My DPL co-host today is Kat. So please message Kat or myself if you have any technical issues or anything like that. And also put your questions in there. Today we didn't have a pre-show, but normally you can tune in up to 30 minutes before the start of the Saturday matinee to enjoy related film and music clips. Our guest today is acclaimed writer William Boyle. So leading today's discussion is film critic Walter Chaw. So please join me in welcoming Walter Chaw and William Boyle.
Morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. You know, I've never, even after a year and a half, been able to stop waving at the Zoom camera, so I'm gonna sit on my hands today. Okay, very, very briefly, I'm gonna go over just a couple of key notes before we get to our incredible guest today. So just starting with the French, as one so often does, right after the war and the post-war period in France, the United States, as you know, the France was rebuilding its own entertainment infrastructure. I'd say it sent over a bunch of movies that it didn't think very much of to sort of fill the theaters and to fill time, you know, as they were rebuilding. It was part of our rebuilding, was this cultural diffusion, if you will. But what we sent them was stuff that we didn't value that much. It wasn't the big blockbuster first run stuff that, you know, that we're showing overseas. We're giving them the stuff that was just sort of junk, we thought, you know, all the genre stuff, the westerns and the thrillers and the gangster movies and horror movies, especially. It's like, go ahead. And so a generation of young French kids, essentially, were brought up watching American films that were, we thought of as garbage. And it took the French, this generation of young French kids, as they grew up and became scholars of those films, to give our culture back to us. We see what happens, you know, recently there's just the last couple of days, this tragedy in Brazil where, you know, a huge storehouse and museum of movie posters and prints and scripts all went up in flames because the fascistic government there, Bolsonaro, did not value culture and essentially laid everybody off and locked the building up. And of course, those things take tending. It seems like whenever we give more money to the cops, we take it away from funding. And so it's poignant to me that in that atmosphere, we're talking a little bit about what we do and don't value as art and whether or not we value art. But anyway, the French looked at all the stuff that we didn't value as art and gave it back to us because they began to see voices and threads weaving through the stuff that we thought was trash. And they said, you know what, there's actually authors to this trash. Occasionally there are movies that we're watching and we're seeing the same themes recurring over and over again, as you would in music or painting or any other kind of artistic expression. They said, there are authors, auteurs here, and let's start talking about them. They began a movie magazine that's still in publication. It's called the Cahier du Cinéma. A guy named Andre Bazin and his partner Jacques Dunoy Valcroze and Joseph Maria Loduca, I don't speak French at all, apologies. Those three guys started the magazine, and they invited their buddies, and they invited other guys that had equally been brought up with the sort of American film genre background to write for them. Some of these critics, you may recognize their names for other reasons. Critics like Eric Rohmer, Claude Chabrol, Francois Truffaut, Jean-Luc Godard, Jacques Rivette. That's right. This is the dawn of the French New Wave. These critics got together to talk about these gangster movies and these horror movies and these thrillers and these films noir, as we're going to be talking about today. And so, and then eventually they became filmmakers. Initially, the French New Wave was a reaction to all of these genres. They were making their versions of them with the French milieu. They were almost academic papers dissecting genre. So if you are a big film nerd, as we all must be, being here today on a Saturday, talking about movies for so long, you must investigate what they're saying when you watch Breathless, investigate what they're saying when you watch The 400 Blows. It is more than just the thing itself, as it were. So the year after this movie Detour came out, the French critics in the Cahier du Cinéma coined a term, film noir, black film, to talk about what these movies were, where Detour fell, where movies like The Maltese Falcon and Double Indemnity, where all those movies fell. The same year that Detour came out, Ulmer did another movie, not Ulmer, but the production company, PRC, did another movie that was originally titled Single Indemnity. So these were all tied into a theme. And what the French wanted to know was why all of these movies in a group. You know, there's all of these time loop movies now, right? One after another, Palm Springs, all these movies coming out. Why do you think during a pandemic, all of a sudden we're watching all these movies about time standing still, repeating? It's interesting, right? For them, for the French, the puzzle was these movements in American cinema. So the puzzle of films noir was, what was it in the American character, in the American feeling, in American zeitgeist that was causing all of these films to begin to erupt at the same time? Movies with broken heroes that were coming back from war, that had a different sense of morality, that was at odds with societal morality. And on the other side, what is it with all these sexy women who have their gender expectations all undermined by going to work during war, Rosie the Riveter, all those things? Not everybody wanted to go back to vacuuming and pearls and high heels. You know, there was something that was scary now about women, especially women's sexuality. And so there are these femme fatale, these deadly women in films noir. There's all sorts of these elements in noir. The visual style plays into it as well. Almost no noir satisfies all of them. Noir, you know, I think Truffaut said it once, noir is more of a feeling than a set of rules. So we'll talk a little bit about how Detour may be in many ways the quintessential noir. Very few noirs feel as bad as Detour does. But there's, with all this to talk about, you know, and last thing I'll say about film noir is our good friend James Elroy refers to film noir. He crystallizes it perfectly. He says, film noir means you're fucked. That's right, film noir. Okay, James Elroy, man of many words. Our guest today is William Boyle. He is an author of four books and one collection of short stories. I think I got that right, Bill. I apologize if I didn't. Among them, his first novel, Gravesend, A Friend is a Gift You Give Yourself, which is really a fascinating multi sort of thing, The Lonely Witness, and his latest, City of Margins. There is a passage in... Yeah, part of my research was I got to read all of Bill's books. You know, research for this is often kind of a treat, and it certainly was for this. In The Lonely Witness by one William Boyle, I want to read this part. It really made an impression on me. I made a note of it. This is, okay. Amy feels guilt and anger and a rush of overwhelming sadness. Everything is regrets. Tears hot in her eyes. She can't look at Alessandro. Amy knows Al's slipping away. And this man who is her father, what on earth's she supposed to say to him now? She'd woken up from many dreams, many nights and mornings, upset by encounters with him that had never even occurred. And now this dreaded door is open. Against her will, it's open. She doesn't see herself in him. Her features aren't his features. She doesn't feel the pull of blood. She wishes he wasn't being nice. She wishes he wasn't sober. She wishes he'd disappear. Man, okay. That's really good stuff, Bill. His latest book, City of Margins, is based, the title, in part on a poem by a guy named Joe Bolton. And I was really kind of stunned that that Bill here is quoting Joe Bolton, not because Bill is not a very brilliant man of letters and obviously knows who Joe Bolton is, but because very few people do. He killed himself at the age of 28 after he'd just written three poetry collections. I dug up a Joe Bolton poem that reminds me a little bit of Detour as well, and sort of the ethos of Bill's writing, which is always about, for me, this really strong sense of loss, this sense of place, a loss of humans that are attached to place, a sense, an elegiac sense to his crime novels and his novels of disaffection. Really brilliant stuff. But anyway, this is a poem by Joe Bolton, and I promise no more poetry reading after this. It's called The Light We Dance Through by Joe Bolton. It's short, but it's brilliant. Here we go. This is the afterlife. Her gin-tinged breath came like a cool injection in my ear. We were dancing after midnight in this place called 32nd Avenue, dancing over cigarette butts and against bodies not our own, and through a light of such blue density, it almost wasn't light at all. But outside, there were stars. And though all around us, the city was playing games with its deranged souls, we danced three times around the parking lot. A waltz, for Christ's sake, a fucking waltz. That was 1981. And each year, there were fewer and fewer people I'll admit as my acquaintances, and fewer still I'll dance with. And it's probably the case that on those all too rare occasions, the light we dance through is the closest we'll ever come to any sort of afterlife. All right. The great Joe Bolton. Without further ado, a guy who's not only brilliant, right? A great writer, really smart about all this stuff. A huge film nerd, as I've been delighted to learn about, and a great guy. So a show of jazz hands for William Boyle. Bill, well, welcome.
Thanks so much for having me, Walter. And thanks to the Denver Public Library. It's really a big honor for me to be here. I've been watching these since almost the beginning, I guess. I think I missed the first few and then caught on at some point, and didn't miss one for a while. And I've since caught up to everything that I have missed. So it's really great to be here.
Well, you know, I always start with a big stupid question, Bill. Why did you pick Detour?
So Detour, you know, was the first movie that came to my mind when you asked me. And you know, I saw Detour for the first time when I was 12. It was really kind of an important year for me of discovering stuff. You know, I knew I loved to read, and I knew I loved to write, and I knew I loved to watch movies. But up to that point, I'd kind of been just, you know, whatever was in front of me, the kind of big popular stuff. I think I knew at that point already that my tastes ran a little dark. You know, I was reading Ed McBain novels as a kid. And you know, certainly watching some crime movies, but that year when I was in sixth grade, it was kind of a 1-2-3 punch of seeing the movie The Grifters and reading the book The Grifters, seeing Blue Velvet for the first time, and this would have been like 1990-ish. And then lucking into seeing Detour, it played on PBS one night. I'm from Brooklyn, New York. And, you know, I think at that point, I'd also kind of like to watch movies with my grandparents, and they would occasionally watch old stuff, and I'd watch it with them. So I kind of got tuned into some of that stuff, and I watched Detour. I was just watching whatever I could watch at that point, I think. And I watched Detour one night. And, you know, I think I felt more than I knew, certainly at that point. I didn't really have any language to explain why it affected me or what about it hit me so hard, but it felt really just raw and like nothing I'd ever seen. You know, it's beginning with the fact that it's short, it's really economical, just this kind of knife thrust of a movie. And, you know, I'd never seen anything like Anne Savage. I'd never seen anything like, you know, the kind of bleakness of it, the obvious kind of cheapness of it. None of that really, you know, again, I wouldn't have had language to understand what I was seeing. I didn't know what rear projection was. I didn't know that they were hiding the fact that, you know, Ulmer was hiding the fact that he didn't have sets by, you know, using fog machines or, you know, I didn't know any of that stuff. I was just knew I was impacted by it. And I think it, you know, it definitely, when I think about why I chose it for today and how it's affected me as a writer, it definitely set many of my obsessions kind of in place. I mean, I could go on and on, just, but the fact that, you know, it's a movie about desperate people doing desperate things, you know, the fact that there are these kind of narrative detours, that it's a failed road trip movie or a road trip movie that actually doesn't really take place on the road at all. You know, unreliability, the lack of polish, you know, the way it deals with class and money and dive spaces and identity and failure, just, you know, the fact that it's about outsiders, you know, people exiled from kind of regular world stuff, you know, all these things. I mean, I could keep going, but, you know, it's definitely, I'm just listing the kind of obsessions that it set in place for me. And, you know, it was tied to other stuff at the time that I was seeing, like Blue Velvet, which I think kind of, or even, you know, some De Palma movies or whatever, you know, and then other kind of classic noir stuff that I discovered after, or around the same time. But, you know, that was really the stuff that just knocked me down and made me want to write that way. It made me want to see all of the other stuff.
Well, it's sort of extraordinary because we talk about tragedy as the fall of kings, right? You know, the Greek tragedy is always like these high elevated people, but to your point, like noir and in particular Detour is in the gutter. It is just the dregs, the most miserable people, you know, they're hucksters and they're these debased folks. We should talk really briefly about the making of it. You sort of touched on it a little bit. You know, it's the legend behind it is florid, right? It's almost like a Herzog movie in terms of the legend being almost as interesting as the film itself. So yeah. Variously over the course of the years, right, people have said, oh, it cost $60,000, or $30,000, or $10,000, or $20,000. It took 6 days, or 4 days, or a week, or 2 weeks. You know, there's all of the stuff that's floating around, and you know, scholars have actually gone in now, including one in particular who wrote. I'm sorry, his name's Noah
Eisenberg. Yeah,
Eisenberg. Yeah, wrote a thing on Ulmer and also a BFI monograph on the film itself, if I'm not mistaken. You're talking about earlier, but you know, he's done so much work, and a lot of people like that have done work for Criterion as well. Came out on the Criterion collection. Can you imagine Ulmer, you know, sitting around, you know, making this Poverty Row picture, saying it's going to be on the most esteemed distribution platform at one sometime in 80 years. But you know, but the reality of it was, I think that it took 14 days to shoot. The budget ended up being a little bit over $100,000, which is not much at all. And to your point, there were no sets. I love the fog when they're walking around in the fog. It just shows like the street signs and then they kind of disappear into the fog. We'll talk a little bit about that in a second. But you know, his company that he was working for, PRC, was the Producers Releasing Corporation. It was part of a bunch of small studios during this period of time called Poverty Row, because they're making all these movies really quickly and on a low budget, including CBC Productions, which eventually became Columbia Pictures, Republic Pictures, which made some pretty big movies ultimately as well. But they sort of began as these Poverty Row companies, and that's where this movie came out of as well. But for me, when I watch it, and it's so unfinished almost feeling, it takes on the feeling, much like Blue Velvet does, of a nightmare. So can you talk to me a little bit about that aspect of Detour, how it occurs mostly in the unconscious, especially of this unreliable, perhaps, narrator.
Yeah, and I've seen it maybe referred to as kind of a head trip movie or head trip noir somewhere along the way, which I think is kind of apt that you have the Tom Neal character there's so much voiceover just telling us the whole story, beginning at the diner and ending at the diner, just him kind of recounting this. And there's a definite level of kind of unreliability there. And, this kind of the fact that he's talking to the audience, he's never, I think maybe I could be wrong, but I think maybe it's the first or one of the first movies to kind of not have that be a confession to someone else, or not have the character talking to someone else, but talking to the audience. So there is definitely a kind of nightmarish element to it, that he's revisiting the hand that fate has dealt him, the bad decisions that have spiraled into other bad decisions that have led him down this dark road. I think that the way Ulmer shot it and the kind of constraints he was under only add to that. There's a claustrophobia to so much of it. I mean, you're really, when you think about the way it's shot, it's, so much of it is just in a car with rear projection, or in these kind of little dive spaces, motel rooms, apartments, diners. And there's, what he does with those spaces is just unreal, because there is a kind of paranoia and tension inherent in every scene in that movie. And there's nothing, there's no spectacular sets, there's no anything. I mean, it's all done through the way he's shooting it and the atmosphere he's created.
Well, I love how you mentioned that the voiceover is directed directly to the audience, because to me, it feels like when you're watching it, like this confession, this desperate confession by a guilty person who can't actually completely keep his story straight.
Right.
And it's like you're just kind of trapped in a room with them. A sort of sweaty sociopath, right? And he keeps talking and talking and talking. He talks himself into this corner. Like, even when he's flashing back to the, disposing of the body of the Bible salesman, right? It shows a flashback. It shows this really unreliable guy saying, well, I had to do it. I had to do it. They would have thought I killed him. Like, really? Would they have thought that you killed him?
Yeah, you'll never believe this. He says that a lot. Right. You'll never believe that. This was the corner I was painted into, but I was.
You'll never believe this woman wrapped a telephone cord around her neck twice before lying down on a bed to make a telephone call or something. You'll never believe that happened. And it's like this desperate sort of sociopath that you're stuck with, right? And so by the end of this, I've only seen this like 3 or 4 times. I can't really bear it, because it just feels so horrible. But By the end of this time watching it, I really felt like, all right, he did this. He's just a serial killer. He's sort of on a spree. And I love how, the production code enforced about 10 years at this point says that you can't have criminals getting away with it at the end of it. So at the end of it, there's this sort of thing where he's like, one day a car is going to stop and it's going to, and he shows them, because, really the note that they got from the censors was he's got to be in custody by the end of this movie. So he does it, but I don't think he's actually been arrested. This is more of that fantasy that he's talking about. I mean, there's something that's really like profoundly unsettling about this film, because you're under the control for a little over an hour of this guy's trying to convince you that he hasn't murdered 2 people.
He kind of tries to beat the code there at the end, I guess. Where you are wondering, is that, I think, fantasy projection kind of the future or what? That was not the ending that he wanted, but what he had to do.
Well, and Ulmer is probably best known for as a horror director. He's the Black Cat was his big breakthrough, in 1934, whenever I think of analogs to this movie, I think of horror movies. The main one that comes to my mind is Carnival of Souls, the great Herc Harvey, which was also made under really difficult conditions, really low budget, really strict time limitations, you know, semi-professional actors, if you will. And it feels the same. And, you know, you mentioned before we got on that it's almost exactly the same length. Both movies are about 107, you know, an hour and 7 minutes or something like that. It's kind of weird how that works out. But, you know, in Carnival of Souls, it's also this sort of like, what's happening? At some point, you feel like I've lost touch with the reality of the piece. And now I'm sort of just living in somebody's headspace. And it's deeply unsettling.
Yeah, absolutely. And we were talking about this earlier. I was kind of searching my mind for other films or other works that have hit me in the way that Detour did, especially that first time. I've seen it a couple of dozen times over the years, I guess. And they are, I think Carnival of Souls is really apt comparison. And we were saying, you know, something like the Texas Chainsaw Massacre or, you know, movies that were shot on, you know, low budget, where there's this real sense of desperation to the process itself, as well as the material. I think that's totally true.
Well, part of what he does that's really disorienting too is that at some point the score becomes diegetic. Like, you know, he's in the apartment and, you know, he's just standing at the window, right? Looking out. He says, sax player, he wish he would stop. It's like, wait a minute, you can hear that? That's not part of the score. You know, everything is all of the, you know, you could say it's amateurish, right? You could say, okay, they don't know what the heck they're doing. But it somehow works in this movie, and all of it works in its favor. The sort of the diegetic score at some point, the saxophone, you know, intruding into the reality of the piece, but also the rear projection. I'm a huge fan, actually, of rear projection, because I think sometimes you use it on purpose for good purpose, like Hitchcock does in Vertigo. You know, whenever people see that, they're like, oh, ha, ha, ha. You know, if you teach it to a modern audience of kids, unfortunately, they'll usually laugh at that. Or Marnie, you know, they'll look at the backdrops and they'll say, oh, that's so fake. You know, my challenge is, you know, this is the guy Hitchcock who did the crop duster sequence. He had no idea that was rear projection. So he knows how to use it. Why isn't he using it now? And when we look at the sort of like forced artificiality of those movies, you compare it with the perhaps accidental artificiality of Detour, and it kind of does the same thing. You feel like you're in an alien aquarium. Yeah. I do. When I watch it, I'm like, what's happening? You know, it feels like the Lars von Trier film Zentropa, which is all shot with rear projection. It feels like to me Mulholland Drive, to speak of another David Lynch, which at one point sort of just becomes rear projection as the two, you know, actresses are sort of like in the wilderness all of a sudden. There's something very surreal and uncanny about the use of that in this movie that, you know, budget, whatever reasons aside, actually feed into the paranoia that you talked about, the claustrophobia of the film.
Yeah.
I'm not doing a good job actually asking questions. I'm just like,
no, absolutely. I totally agree with that.
So talk to me about the capitalism. I always like to talk about capitalism, that you're sort of talking about, the class divide, the talk about, you know, when the guy gives him a $10 tip when he's playing the piano, and he's like, what does he say about it? He's like, it's just a piece of paper crawling with germs. So there's a real class struggle that's going on in this movie. People that are really desperate. Talk to me a little bit about how that fuels your work and your worldview at the tender age of 12. What did that do to you to think about money that way?
Well, you know, I don't know if that, I don't know how that would have impacted me, or I don't remember quite how that impacted me at that time on those first viewings, but it was probably something that certainly shaped my worldview, that I was definitely drawn to stories of people on the margins. And, you know, this is that. I mean, this is a story of, you know, a guy who, and there's even there, I should say, there's even more of that stuff in the novel. And I Ulmer didn't like the novel, I don't think, but I like the novel a lot. You know, there's a lot of kind of meditations on that stuff. So this idea that, you know, people have to be regular, that they have to work regular jobs and make money and you know, just kind of feed the machine. You know, I, obviously I like I like stories of characters kind of working the edges of that, or characters rejected by that system, or characters who are rejecting that system. And I think, you know, Al in this movie and in the book, he's Alex in the book, I think. He's a kind of musical prodigy. In the book, he's a violinist. In the movie, he's a pianist. And you know, so I think he's having to work these kind of scrubby club jobs, even though he's a classic, you know, jazz kind of like jazz clubs, even though he's a classically trained musician. So there's a lot of stuff about class, and it kind of gets blurry for me because a lot of that stuff's not in the movie really, but in the book is very prominent. The fact that he is kind of rejected by this kind of classical world or working outside of it and kind of feels like an outsider, that kind of prompts him to start this journey. I think I've always been kind of obsessed with that, characters who reject that and who set out on their own and who are paranoid about that or upset by the fact that they can't fit in or that they can't be what people think they should be or something like that. So, I mean, I think Detour is kind of a classic example of that, because you have all these, I mean, basically every major character that we meet is some version of that. From Vera to Sue to Haskell to Al, like they're all people who are working the edges and have been rejected or in the process of being rejected and are trying to survive and trying to find some purpose. And obviously, you know, I think that money comes into that. The fact that, you know, if you don't have it, you know, that's, you feel like you can't exist in this society in the way that people want you to. There's all sorts, again, this doesn't really come into the movie as much, but there's all sorts of class stuff in the book in terms of, you know, him being kind of a working class kid guy who is trying to break into this kind of elitist classical scene.
Well, there is that monologue, that voiceover in the film that I love, that reminds me of the Fargo, the last monologue in Fargo, where he talks about money as, you know, what that, you know, that thing that nobody ever has enough of and everybody's killing themselves to get and everything. It reminded me a lot of Fargo, which is like, you know, here's a beautiful day and what'd you do all this for? Just a little bit of money, you know, and like money seems to be the root of all of it. Talk to me a little bit about the treatment of women in this movie as well. In particular, the great and savage as Vera, one of the most dangerous performances of all time, perhaps. How does Detour see women?
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, I feel bad I didn't say that in the beginning when you asked me why Detour. Obviously, one of the things that first struck me about this movie was Anne Savage's performance, which is just unreal. I'd never seen anything like it as a kid. I still can say I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like it. It is just, Noah Eisenberg says, you know, she drops into the movie and, you know, she drops in and puts a headlock on the movie. I think what Guy Madden's line is that it's a role as much fairly attacked as performed. And it's just one of my favorite, probably one of my 5 or 10 favorite performances in any movie. So there's that. But her character, you know, I mean, obviously, I think her character is not treated well, but we are seeing this all through the lens of an unreliable, you know, unlikable guy. And I actually, the more I like, I mean, I'm so fascinated by her character. I'm so kind of obsessed with her character. I think she's just a really rich kind of villain in this movie. You know, there's so much story under the surface. I mean, she drops into this movie for 30 minutes, I think. I mean, I think that's her screen time. Maybe it's a little bit less even. You don't know anything about Vera. You don't even know Vera's her real name. I think she says, when she comes in, she says, "You could call me Vera if you like." or something like that. So you don't even know that's her real name, and you don't really know her backstory too much, other than the fact that Haskell picked her up and expected something from her, and she scratched the hell out of him, and you know, he kicked her out, and then you know, she gets Al has the bad luck of running into her further down the road. So I mean, you don't know a lot of her backstory. You don't know the hardships that she's come through or what kind of bad situations she's encountered. I think there are real moments of tenderness though for Vera. I mean, one of rewatching it last night, I mean, one of the things that struck me again is there's that scene where they're kind of fighting at the end and Al puts his hand on her or something, and she says, you know, she just says, "You hurt me. You really, you know, you hurt me." There's a real sadness and tenderness in her eyes. So, you know, I think she's such a complicated character, and I'm just endlessly fascinated by her. Sue is not, you know, Sue gets thrown out of this movie basically. So there's, you know, I could see people who only know this film and haven't read the novel, thinking that Sue is just kind of thrown aside and is this one-dimensional kind of, as you said earlier, I think before we went on, kind of the siren call for Al to go from New York to LA. But in the book, she gets her own thread. So a lot of the story is Sue Harvey's, and it's really kind of like a they shoot horses, don't they-ish Hollywood satire of her getting there, kind of failing as an actress, working at a hot dog stand, going on a date with this actor who she sleeps with and then rejects, and he tries to kill himself. And there's this whole other thread to the plot where she becomes really complicated too. And kind of reminds me of Gloria from They Shoot Horses, Don't They? And her kind of sad, brutal outlook, and just, you know, the fact that she's, it's kind of, you know, a Hollywood, kind of classic Hollywood thing of her just wanting to get something, to get some level of success and being spit out by the system. So, I mean, those are the women of the movie, and really it's just Vera in this Detour, in 1945's Detour. But the book and the remake, which we might or might not mention, you know, spend a little bit more time. Well, the book spends a lot more time with Sue, and the remake tries to. And I think the original script, Martin Goldsmith's original script, did have that Sue thread, but Ulmer cut it. You know, probably I can't remember if it was wholly because of time and budgetary constraints. But it was just axed. So yeah, it's a hard movie on women, but I think it's a hard movie on everybody. I mean, it's a bleak thing. I mean, it does certainly not, you know, I mean, the men look terrible in this movie. I mean, there's nobody good in this movie. There's nobody likable. There is no goodness in the Detour cinematic universe,
I'm really fascinated by Sue and the way that Ulmer chooses to portray them, for whatever reason, budgetary or otherwise. But you know, I really think that now she becomes the femme fatale in the movie. When we talk about the deadly female in noir, usually they're the ones that are luring our fallen hero to some kind of doom through promises. You know, you think of Barbara Stanwyck and Double Indemnity, where you know, they're using their sexual wiles or whatever, promises or body heat. Kathleen Turner, the great neo-noir. But, you know, I don't see Vera as that. I see her as something very different. She's almost the noir hero in the film. And Sue actually becomes the fatale for me because she's the representation of something that he desires that he can never have. You know, he becomes a kind of a Billy Wilder character in her presence. You know, he wants the keys to the executive washroom, which is Sue. And, you know, I love when he calls her, you know, when he's like, he throws his coat over the phone. He's really calm. She doesn't say anything. You know, it's this really weird, at least we don't see her, you know, it's like, we don't really know, because he's the narrator, whether or not she actually still exists for him. Is she really a person in his life, or is this the idealized notion of the woman that, you know, a lot of us pathetically hold in our minds, you know, especially when we're younger, and say, this is the idealized woman that we're putting up on a pedestal without really dealing with the idea that once you idealize a woman, you objectify them and you kill them, you know, in your mind. They can never live up to what you hope that they will be. And so she becomes that. She's like Beatrice for him, you know, yeah. At the end of this tour of the Inferno, he can never really quite get to her, although he does in the Inferno. We'll set that. Anyway, but yeah, this is just the Inferno part of the Divine Comedy. And I think it's, yeah, again, it's one of those divine creations, this film, right? It's like, whatever the circumstances, why this happened, why that didn't happen, if it's they didn't have money, it all kind of builds together into this piece that actually works. Talk to me a little bit about Haskell, about, you know, his monologue, his terrifying monologue about women and defanging women, and, you know, the really open misogyny, and how maybe that begins to shape the Vera character. These people all seem like imaginary parts of Al's mind. I'm not being articulate, am I? I'm just, there's just something like really phantasmagoric to me about this film.
No, you are. Yeah, I totally agree. And he's a kind of terrifying character. And, you know, it kind of is only hinted at in the movie, but he's a con man, and he's, you know, he got into a duel as a young man with another kid in his town, and poked the kid's eye. You know, he got cut, but he gouged the kid's eye out and left and never came back. And that's why he's headed back to California to reconnect with his sick father and try to, like, you know, get, I mean, you know, some of this in the movie. But he's also a villain. I mean, I think he's the hand that gets dealt to Al. I mean, you know, that anybody could have picked him up, but he gets picked up, which is, you know, obviously one of the recurring things in the movie is, you know, fate sticks out its foot and trips you, and it trips him up with Haskell, who's this, you know, ostensibly friendly guy at first, who's, you know, going to take him all the way in exchange for Al driving a bit, gives him a meal, and then slowly reveals himself to be this, you know, yes, this misogynist, evil con man figure. And then he, you know, he's dead, you know, very fairly quickly, of, you know, well, if we believe Al, maybe nothing, maybe natural causes, or maybe he did actually fall out of the car and hit his head on the rock. And, or, you know, if we don't believe Al, then Al rolled him and killed him. But either way, you know, he's this kind of monster that Al meets on the road. And I think that definitely adds to the horror nightmare quality of the movie.
So do you buy it, Bill, that it's just faith? Do you buy that all of this sort of self-pitying, like, it could have happened to anybody? This kind of stuff just happens to people, right?
Like, yeah,
it's never happened to me. So I mean, I guess my question is this, like, do you buy it? What's happening here exactly with that monologue, with that voiceover?
You know, I mean, I don't think I ever really questioned it or cared too much. You know, I think I've always loved stories about chance and coincidence, and I know, you know, noir often relies on that stuff in some heavy way, and so I think, especially as a young viewer, I didn't question it. I just thought, yeah, I mean, that's, weird things happen. This movie relies on suspension of disbelief in some respect, but I like that. I mean, I like that as a fan of films and literature. You know, I mean, I like being led down some strange path that I, you know, that yeah, it might be a kind of you know, heightened version of reality, or even a heightened version of the kind of chance and coincidence that occurs in the real world, but that doesn't matter to me and too much. I mean, you know, and I love the film's focus on fate. And that, you know, that Vera brings it back at the end a couple of times, and with her talk about, like, you know, being in the ninth inning of a ball game, kind of, you know, that noir relies on that, and the kind of crime fiction I love relies on, you know, bad decisions and bad luck. And like you said, that Elroy line, you're fucked. I mean, that is what it's about. I mean, this movie is just about getting fucked again and again. You know, I mean, you just kind of keep stumbling into bad situations. And it begins before he goes on the road, really. It begins in New York for him. So, yeah, I mean, I guess I do buy it, or I want to buy it.
Yeah, I like the idea that sin is transferable almost in this film. Like, it seems like he's like passing one another. And also there's an unconscious element where they're sleeping and then she wakes up and has like this revelation. It seems like there's like something very like Freudian, if you want to go there, that's going on.
Oh, yeah.
I think we could go on for hours, but we should ask if there are any questions that we can answer for our esteemed group today. Andrew, what do we got?
Trevor made a point that I liked, I wanted to share, that he said, like Al, Haskell characterizes his severe violence in his past as an accident. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
And then let's see, Megan asked, you'd love to know, Bill, if you think Tom Neal's personal dramas add something to the watching of the movie now.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think so. I mean, if you hear, I was rewatching, I guess maybe it was in the Ulmer documentary, or maybe it was in Noah Eisenberg's book, I can't remember where. Ulmer talks about that later, that basically Tom Neal, who murdered his wife in the was it the late 50s or early 60s?
His third wife. It was only his third wife.
It's very similar what he does, and you know, is very similar to what Al does to Vera, kind of. And the you know, Ulmer says that basically in this interview. I think it's the interview with Bogdanovich where he says, basically, Tom Neal became Al, or Detour came true for Tom Neal. So I think, yeah, I mean, it's impossible now to watch the movie without that knowledge. Certainly I didn't know that as a kid when I saw it. I didn't know anything about Tom Neal. I just knew he was this kind of, you know, I knew he was an actor I hadn't seen that you know, was kind of a B John Garfield or a B Bogart or something. And it probably wasn't until much later in my 20s that I knew any of the history, but yeah, it definitely casts a different shadow over the movie and adds another layer. I mean, it's a mean movie and it adds another layer of meanness to the movie to know that Tom Neal was kind of, you know, this monster or became this monster too.
Yeah, I mean, I think he had been a monster. He was a prize fighter, he was a boxer, and he had a really famous affair with a starlet named Barbara Payton. And Barbara Payton, she has a ghostwritten memoir that's incredible. It's called I Am Not Ashamed, you know, and it was written during a period of time late in her life where she had become actually a prostitute, and she was a heroin addict and an alcoholic, and I was hanging out, you know, around Hollywood Boulevard, and there it is, I'm Not Ashamed, and she's clutching a box of tissues in that picture, which is, you know, it's amazing. But she and Tom Neal had this affair on again, off again, while she was engaged to Franchot Tone, the really handsome movie star of some elegance and regality. But she had, you know, affairs with Bob Hope, notoriously, a lot of people. And she was always on the losing end of the gossip train. Whenever people would say, oh, Bob Hope has, you know, this woman on the side and she's paying for her rent at an apartment, is paying for her furs and paying for all of this stuff. You know, he's like forgiven because he's Bob Hope. And Barbara was not, because she's just some, you know, strumpet. And that's the Britney Spears of our culture, the Megan Fox, where we are very quick to condemn the woman who's made no promises versus the man who's made all of them. And so it's a really tragic story of Barbara Payton. But while she was engaged to Franchot Tone, Tom Neal confronted Tone on the lawn, the front lawn, said, come out here, I'll fight you for the honor of the hand of Barbara Payton, and beat Franchot Tone into an 18-hour coma. It was like sort of the huge scandal, as you can imagine at the time. Imagine, you know, Tom Cruise beat Brad Pitt into a coma. It'd be the other way around, probably. Tom Cruise is a very small man. But it was a huge scandal, and it essentially ended both of their careers, Tom Neill's and Barbara Payton's. This happened around 1951, and neither of them really got much work afterwards. They actually sort of parlayed their notoriety into an off-Broadway run of The Postman Always Rings Twice, strangely enough, where they were like sort of pilloried for being terrible actors, but people went nonetheless because they wanted to see this notorious, you know, this Bonnie and Clyde or whatever. After Franchot-Tone woke up from his coma, Barbara says, I'll marry you. I'm so sorry. They get married 53 days later after Franchot discovers that she's still sleeping with Tom Neill on the side, divorces him. And so there's all this other side conversation about Tone and all other luminaries in Hollywood. But that's how Barbara Payton sort of intersects with Tom Neill's life. But Tom Neill, kind of playing himself. And when you watch Detour, and the more that you know about Tom Neill's life, and the more that you know about, you know, manslaughter, he shot his wife in the back of the head, and he said it was because they were wrestling for a gun, and he left the body undiscovered for a day. And the police are like, why didn't you? Like, but he was convicted, and I think he spent 6 years in jail. That's it for manslaughter. And then he was out again. He became a gardener. So anyway, So obviously, the more that you know about some of these things, the more that they become, it feeds the feeling of desperation for me and seediness of the movie.
And since we're talking about Barbara Payton, one of the people who did in those post 1951 years give her work was Ulmer, and she's in her last movie is an Ulmer movie, which is called Murder Is My Beat, which is also, you know, it's 1955, I think. So I think it's a decade after Detour, and it's her last movie, and it's another, you know, cheap kind of short crime thing, and it's pretty good. It's not, you know, to me it's not on the level of Detour or Ruthless, which I also really love, or maybe even The Strange Woman, but it's solid and interesting, and she's still, even though she's kind of at the end of her run and starting to look rough because she was, you know, heavily into booze and stuff. She's really good in it, and it's an interesting movie to watch.
The author and critic Kim Gordon writes a really, really great, Kim Morgan, excuse me, writes a really, really great appreciation of Barbara Payton. So if you do a quick Google search or something, we'll send a link to. It's really, really strong. But yeah, Tom Neill, and you know, this whole, yeah, all the story. Noir was often a reflection of reality and not just an art. So yeah, other questions?
Okay, so Jen asked, this film is about storytelling and the idea of don't say too much or be careful who you tell your secrets to. It deals with blackmail. Do you think this film might have been influenced by the Red Scare or by blacklisting in Hollywood or the idea of like, who can you trust? I would add maybe kind of the paranoia after World War II of being afraid of the enemy and that type of thing.
Well, I think, Ulmer was he was blackballed by Hollywood after The Black Cat because he married, the woman he married was married to Carl Lamel's nephew. And, you know, he broke up that marriage, and Carl Lamel, I don't ever know if I'm saying that name right, sorry, blackballed Ulmer from Hollywood after that. And then he worked on this series of, you know, Yiddish movies and a bunch of other stuff, and was kind of outside of the system until he came to Poverty Row. So I think a lot of what's in Detour is in Ulmer's view, probably, and Noah Eisenberg talks about this a lot, you know, there's autobiography in there. You know, Ulmer loved music. And then also certainly, you know, you have so many of the great noir directors were from, like Ulmer, Vienna, or the provinces of Vienna, you know, were from Germany, were from Europe. And there is a big sense of being an outsider and being exiled in Hollywood, especially during this time. So you know, I think that adds up to a lot of that. I mean, I think it's pre, you know, it's kind of pre Red Scare, but definitely a lot of that kind of, you know, for Ulmer personally, being an outsider, you know, being cast aside in Hollywood and being working outside the studio system that he wanted, even though he said he didn't want to be a part of, he kind of wanted to be a part of. And, you know, being an outsider in so many other ways, I think, you know, definitely influences that.
Yeah, I think it's really pertinent to talk about his contemporaries, the people like Billy Wilder and Robert Schoedmack and Fred Zinnemann and Eugene Shifton. And, you know, these are the guys that have fled Nazi Germany, and their work, Fritz Lang, their work is suffused in the United States and in Paris and in Mexico, wherever they went to exile. Their work created in exile is suffused with paranoia and fear of persecution and fear of mobs, fear of people, fear of, you know, all of this stuff. And I think, you know, the comparison to Billy Wilder in my mind is based on that, because Wilder's heroes are always these kind of jerks, but they want to be part of a larger story or larger structure, the safe, you know, protected in some way by the ruling culture, and they never quite are able to achieve that in whatever way, or after their death, and a lot of Wilders, a lot of terrible stuff is found out about them. It's, you know, men of secrets, men of pasts, men of aspirations that are unfulfillable. Ulmer, no less so, you know. And I love that you mentioned The Strange Woman. It's a Hedy Lamarr, right? The 1945 or 46. I love that movie, because again, it's a lot like Vera in Detour. It's a heroine who is unapologetic about her ambition. She doesn't apologize. Well, she apologizes at the very, very end, but, you know, when it's too late. But, you know, there's no apology about who they are and what they are and what they want. And it's like, it's great. And Ulmer and a lot of these filmmakers as well, you know, Zinnemann too, that empathy and that sympathy with it fuels this whole period of American film. You know, Hollywood wouldn't be Hollywood without World War II. Other questions? Maybe time for one or two more questions.
Dixie and John asked kind of a practical question. I was kind of curious too. I don't know if either of you know. Did Tom Neal actually play the piano in that, or was that a professional?
Oh, I doubt it. He was a big galoot, right? Tom Neal.
Well, he did go to, I think he didn't, he went to Yale or Harvard or somewhere. He was like, came from a really wealthy family, but then he was also like, you know, boxer and a, I don't know the answer to that question. I can't remember if it comes up in the book, but this is the Noah Eisenberg book on Detour, which I highly recommend. If the answer would be anywhere, it'd probably be in there. And this is his biography of Ulmer that I love. I don't know the answer to that question. I doubt it.
Yeah, I think, he went to Northwestern, it looks like.
Oh, Northwestern, okay.
Yeah, it's those rich guys that you got to watch out for, as we've discovered, I think.
Curious. The piano playing is impressive. So if the film is 70 minutes long, do you think the short length and the tight editing contribute to the effectiveness of the narrative? Or how do you feel editing plays in a creative work?
I think it does. I mean, I think, you know, the economy of it, to me, definitely is one of the first things about it that had a big impact on me. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, I love pre-code cinema a lot. And, you know, so many of those movies are 67, 65, 63, 70, whatever minutes. And I'm always amazed at how much people do in that short a time when you think about the bloat of so much contemporary stuff, especially. And, you know, we're immediately in Detour, immediately in the midst of this desperation. There's no building up to it. There's no origin story. There's no exposition, even though there's a ton of voiceover. I mean, there's no, you know, there's no taking time to get there. We're in it. We're in with these characters in crisis mode, and we're in this desperate story right away, and it doesn't let up. It's relentless for 67 minutes. And so I think that definitely adds to the overall effect of the movie. And, you know, if it had 20 additional minutes of the Sue Harvey stuff as the remake does, it would probably slow it down and kind of take away from that effect somewhat.
Yeah, and I'll give the more boring answers that, you know, a lot of these movies were short because they were literally programmers. They were just meant to fill space and stuff. And they wanted to get as many showings in as possible. And they also wanted to fit it on as few reels as possible. So, you know, they would save on shipping. They would save on reproduction costs. They would save on all of this stuff. And so hence the length of a lot of these movies. A lot of these movies were about an hour long, a little bit over an hour. So it's good. But, you know, I'm of a mind, though, and I'm of a mind that most movies shouldn't be 2 hours long. I think 90 minutes is a really good length for movies. And that's like, you know, very broad generalization. You can give me hundreds and hundreds of examples of why movies are great, movies are longer. I get it. Yeah, you're absolutely right. But for the most part, I've never seen a great movie that was too short. I've never seen a good movie that, you know, a bad movie that was too long. And so I really think the hour really helps it just to sort of like, it's nasty and dirty. I think you called it a knife stab of a movie. Yeah. All right, we're right up against our time. We're ending today with a song of a favorite of Bill's, I think. It's a Lou Reed song that he credited at one point for, you know, filling his imagination with the kind of stories a Brooklyn kid could someday write. And so huge thanks to William Boyle for coming here today. Thank you, Bill, for coming and for choosing this amazingly bleak film.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me, Walter. Thank you to the library. Thank you to everybody who came out. It's really great. Appreciate it.
Okay, here we go, guys. Lou Reed.
Take me for what I am, a star newly emerging. Long simmering explodes inside the self is reeling. From the muscle in the heart and the rushing of the blood, the muscle of my sex and the mindless. Mindful love, oh, mindful love. I accept the new found man and set the twilight reeling. At 5 a.m. the moon and sun sit set before my window. Light glances off the blue glass we set right before the window. And you accept in your mind and your head what was misunderstood, what was thought of with dread. A new self is born and the other self dead. I says I. And I says shows and sweating. He sinks to one knee. try. The horns are unrelenting, baby. As the drummer's beat, he finds the face growing large. In the microphone's face, he sees her grace growing large. And the swelling crescendo no longer retards. I says, now I.